dreams come true. You make dreams come true.
I'm a wounded shell. I'm a restless hurt. I get a few things right, but still I find myself in trouble.
I'm a loaded gun. I'm a full-blown worry. I'm a reckless soldier trying to crawl out of the rubble.
It's hard to see the light from underneath. All these failures got me wondering.
That's why I throw my bones in the river. Sing my teeth in a good time. That's why I brace myself every minute, try to hold on tight for a good ride. Fools like us are only here to prove you make dreams come true. You make dreams come true.
I'm a small town boy, I'm a winding story.
I'm only half the man I was when I was 20. And it wasn't what we chalked it up to be when we were kids in Carolina, Tennessee.
So I throw my bones in the river.
All right, guys, we're going to get started. Please stand while we worship.
If y'all don't mind, if y'all can scoot a little closer, that way we can just be closer together while we worship. We're also going to kind of speak a little bit after this as well. So we'll come down to you guys, that way we're a little closer.
Forsaken, I am who you say I am. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am.
Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for giving us breath in our lungs, Lord. Thank you for giving us this time to worship you, Lord. And I pray that you open our hearts and our ears to hear what you have to say, Lord. And in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So this next part, three of us are going to share our testimonies to share what God has done in our lives. And something that kind of ties back into worship and worship, what worship means to us as well. So, yeah.
Guys, my name is Andrew. What's up, basketball guys? my name is Andrew. I'm from Farwell, Texas, about an hour west from here. I'm a sophomore. I play basketball for the JV team here. And I also play cajon, as you could tell, you know. So like Rosa said, we're just sharing our testimonies today and just talking a little about our walk in faith. So let's get started. I grew up in the church. My family was very religious. We were always in the church all the time. I was there Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, you know, all of the above. But as a kid, I never really enjoyed church. I liked the fun Sunday school classes and like all that little type of stuff. But like when it came to the big service and worship, I did not like it. I thought it was super boring. You know, I didn't really want to be there. I'd either fall asleep or start drawing in a notebook. And I just really enjoyed it that much. But since I was in church, I knew a ton about God. I could tell you verses, stories, you know, all of the above. But I didn't actually know him. I didn't have a relationship with God. I just knew a ton about him. So I didn't really build an actual relationship with God until probably like my junior year. It wasn't until I got older. One way I started growing him was actually playing the cajon. In middle school, I used to always do this little pencil taps. I don't know if y'all know what that is, but you get the pencil, you start tapping on the desk. I would do that everywhere. My parents hated me for it. They'd be yelling 24/7 like, dude, you gotta stop. You are banging on the bathroom wall. Like, what is going on? So, you know, I'd grab forks, spoons, highlighters, markers, pencils, anything, you know, and I just start tapping with it, and they had enough of it. They're like, dude, you gotta chill out, you gotta stop. But they were actually talking to my great-grandma about it, and she actually bought me that cajon. So I started practicing on it, and I got a little better as I started practicing, you know, dropped the pencils and stuff. But at church, I'd start doing the same thing to the chair in front of me. I'd start banging on it, and one of the worship leaders actually saw it. They're like, maybe we should give this kid a try. Maybe he's halfway decent, you know? So they had me start playing with them on my cajon, and I got better and better, started practicing and stuff. But being involved in worship that way really made me enjoy it a lot more. You know, being live in it and being able to contribute to it and use your talents, it's completely different. It's so awesome being up there. But from this point on, my relationship with God was kind of a roller coaster. I'd be super on fire for him and then like super cold, and it'd just be back and forth all the time. One of my biggest falls was actually my late sophomore year. I played basketball for the JV team at my high school, and the basketball guys on that team weren't the best. They like to, you know, do drugs, smoke, party, you know, all that type of stuff. And me being kind of like the weirdo of the group, I wanted to fit in. So I started doing that stuff as well. You know, I started smoking, started doing drugs, and it really led me down this super, super dark path. And it felt like I got stuck in the valley that only seemed to get darker. And my junior year, I got in this super toxic relationship that just pushed me away further and further from God. And I just remember laying down one night, and I went to bed and I prayed for the first time in a while. I was like, God, I don't know what I should do here. You know, should I continue this relationship and just continue pushing you away and just completely shut it off? Or should I cut off this relationship and start building my life again in you? Because I'd be super on fire, super cold. I just wasn't sure because it was so back and forth all the time. And in that prayer, I asked him to open and close doors as he sees fit and let his will be done. And sure enough, he did. So that girlfriend that I had a toxic relationship with, we went to prom. You know, we're dancing, having a good time. I forgot what it was, but we started like bickering at each other and kind of got in this little fight. And it wasn't a super huge prom, but there's probably like 100 or more people. And everybody saw it. Like everybody started to start fighting, kind of like arguing with each other. And she broke up with me right there in front of everyone. So it was super awkward, super weird. The most awkward part was I drove her dad's truck to prom. So we had to ride back in her truck right after we broke up. So that was pretty awkward. But we got to her house. I dropped off the truck. She gave me my stuff. I got in my car and I started going home. And I'm just driving, heartbroken, sad. Like, what the heck? This really just happened. I just got broken up with at prom. Like, that is just nuts. But I remember turning down the dirt road to my house and like realization kind of set in. I was like, wait, you know, I just prayed for this. I asked God to open and close doors as he sees fit. And that's exactly what he did. Except he didn't close it, he slammed it in my face. But yeah, I kind of like realized like that's how much God loves me. He's gonna cut off this relationship that is super toxic, that's pushing me away further and further so that I can focus on him and really just build my life up with him. And from that point on, I try to pursue God in every way I can and give all glory to him. I still have ups and downs, but I know that I can always trust in him and that he's always got my back. I love God, he loves me. And it's just super awesome knowing that. I actually got baptized May of 2022. So it was actually right before I came to college. So I thought that was super awesome. But yeah, that's my walk in faith. That's my testimony. So thank you guys for listening. I'll see y'all.
Hey, y'all. So that's really loud. Wow. My name is Sarah Manchi. I'm from Amarillo, Texas. And I'm double majoring in elementary education and Christian ministry, and I'm also not great at staying within time limits, so I'm gonna watch my time really closely on this. So, little spoiler alert, my testimony doesn't really revolve around me coming to know Christ because I did grow up in the church. My mom worked at the church for a long time, so pretty much every waking hour that wasn't at school was inside the walls of my church. And I gave my life to him when I was 7 years old, so there's your little heads up that that's not what this is about. But it is more about me recognizing and accepting God's provision, especially in the past couple of years. I always knew that I wanted to come to Wayland. I was actually born in Plainview, and I'm a legacy student. Both my parents got their master's here, my dad got his bachelor's at Wayland. And so I always knew, like, this is where I wanted to be. But I'm also a really big introvert, and that will come into play in just a moment. So I graduated high school in 2020, which obviously was COVID year. We didn't have graduation, didn't have prom or anything like that. But during that time, towards the beginning of the pandemic, my mom also caught COVID, and she had a really bad case of it. She was in the hospital for 5 days, was really close to be putting on a ventilator. And so it came time for me to come to Wayland, and there wasn't a whole lot going on campus because we were obviously trying to social distance, trying to keep each other safe. And so I was heading home every weekend, spend time with my family and all of that. And so I wouldn't spend a whole lot of time around people because I would claim that it was because I didn't want to bring anything home to my mom, which was true. I didn't want to see her go through that again. But it was also a lot because that was what I was used to. That's what I was comfortable with. I liked just being able to keep to myself and do things like I wanted to, plus the masks were a little uncomfortable, so, you know, I'd spend more time in my room where I didn't have to wear it. And so I got into this routine of, You go to class, you go to work, you pick up your food to go to from the calf and go back to your room, and that's where you spend the rest of your time. And it really became normal for me. It became okay. I was fine with that. There wasn't any issue with it. And whenever my parents would ask me how things were, I would say, oh yeah, it's fine. I'm making friends. I'm doing great. Everything's great at college. But in my mind, I also knew I'm only here for 4 years. 4 years of just hanging out in my room sounds fantastic. I love that idea. And it wasn't, it didn't really matter to me if I was involved in community or if I had a whole bunch of friends or knew that I had people to lean on. So I finished my freshman year with maybe two friends, which for being on campus for 9 months is not a whole lot. And so sophomore year kind of started the same, and I know a lot of y'all are freshmen or sophomores or weren't here during COVID, but we had masks longer than a lot of the Texas schools did. We got rid of them a year ago. Last spring was our last semester that we still had them. So it was a long time, and it was because of that, it was still easy for me to just hang out in my room and do things like that. But we got a new choir director that year. Dr. Harrington came, and it was a really good year. I enjoyed choir. That was my special time. But then she told us that we were going on a choir tour. And I thought, that is a lot of hours in a row with a lot of people that I wasn't sure I wanted to spend that long with. Like I said, I just didn't really like being around people, and I'd gotten out of practice of it as well. And so it came time for the choir tour, and I was dreading it. I was counting down the minutes until it was over. But every night in the hotel, we would have game night, and we would just kind of all gather up and play board games and everything. And God really showed me in that opportunity that, hey, I've put these people within reach of you, and they're great people, and they love you, and they want to take care of you, and they want to be in your life, and they want you in their life. And so that was a really cool opportunity for me to have. It was definitely something that I wasn't super comfortable with. But anyway, in that moment, God showed me that we weren't made to be alone. And you can look back into creation, and God made everything, and then he made man, and then said, it's not good for man to be alone, and gave him someone else to be with him. And so it wasn't until then, I didn't realize how lonely I was until that loneliness was gone, until I realized that there were people there, and realized that there were people who wanted to pour into me. And I started finding joy in being with his people, which was definitely a new thing for me. And at the end of that trip, that's when Koinonia applications were due for the next year. And I was so used to just take care of the bare minimum, take care of your classes, go to work, and all of that, that doing extra stuff outside of that wasn't really what I was interested in. So I had those conversations, we had those game nights, and I got to know those people. And the Koinonia applications to be a K-parent were due. Which I did not have a great experience at my Koinonia. It was a lot of people. It was very restricted because of COVID. And so I had it set in my mind, I'm not doing that. There's no way. I'm not going to be a care parent. But in the span of a day, I decided to submit my application to be a K parent. And just trusting that God was going to give me opportunities to continue having people invest in me and seeing the joy in being around his people. So I applied for Koinonia, and then within 3 days of getting back from the choir tour, Lindsay Sumner reached out to me. She's currently clinical teaching. She's doing music ed, so really excited for her. But she reached out to me and told me that she was starting a ministry on campus called Delight and asked me if I would be a leader. And so I could just see God was putting opportunity after opportunity in front of me to accept his challenge to step out in faith and to be around people and to minister to people. So Lindsay asked me about Delight, and within a couple of days after that, Donnie Brown sent out an email about chapel worship team auditions. And I saw that, and I hadn't sang in front of people alone since I was 11 years old. And I thought, that might be a little too much, God. I don't know what you think you're doing with that. But I decided to trust him, and I said, if this is what he wants me to do, then he'll have me make the team. And if it's not, so what? And so I sent in my application for that, and obviously I'm up here now. So we see how that went. And so it was a lot of doing things that I wasn't comfortable with. and trusting that God would do great things with that. And so I came out of my shell and found the joy of being around his people and having opportunities to share his love with them. And like I said earlier, I'm an elementary education major. I've worked several summers in my church's children's ministry, so I like working with little kids. College kids, y'all kind of scare me a little bit, you know? No offense, but God really gave me opportunities to see his goodness and to see his provision in giving me opportunities to minister to y'all and to just to do life with people my age. So thank you for listening.
I'm Rosa Ramirez. I'm currently a junior here at Wayland. This is my third year. So my story is a little bit like Sarah's. I grew up in the church, and my family also did as well. Point where I was born in Fort Worth because my parents were serving at a church there, and then we moved back to Lubbock. And so I say I'm really from Lubbock. I've lived most of my life there. So my parents are worship pastors. My mom plays the piano, my dad plays guitar, sings, my mom sings. They have a bunch of instruments in their arsenal, which is really cool. And one could say we're a musical family. My brother also plays the trumpet, guitar. He can sing, but he doesn't like to. I sing, play piano. So growing up, we've been playing at different places. My parents are always asked to play at this event or this event. Always every Sunday, if I wasn't at school or at my home, I was definitely at church. So with that, you know, just kind of traveling with them and being with them and kind of feeling like church was I have to go because my parents go and my whole family goes, so I guess I will too. I ended up accepting Jesus into my heart in second grade, which is pretty young, but I felt like I knew that he was calling me and that I was his. I don't think that I fully understood what that meant and like giving that all to him until probably my junior year of high school, which is a lot of years in between that. And I had been serving in my church for a while. I even did like worship for my own peers as a kid. So worship has been in my family for a long time. When I got to about my junior year and my senior year, you know, things were wrapping up in high school. It was time for me to make a decision where to go to college. I applied to all these different schools. Wayland was my last choice. I had to like pay for my application to come here. That's how late it was. But the Lord really put something on my heart. He was like, no, like, you know, do this, because Donnie Brown called me. He was like, what are you doing? Why didn't you apply? So I applied, ended up getting in and stuff, and I have an amazing scholarship that the Lord has blessed me with, and I'm able to go all 4 years in my higher education. So when I got here, we're just gonna like fast forward to my freshman year, I started out as a computer science major. It's great. I love math, so, you know, math is my minor. Very new people. I didn't really have a big circle at home, but when I got to college, I was like, I don't know anyone. Literally, like, two people came from my high school, and I really wasn't friends with them, and then I had a roommate that I didn't even know, so I had to get to know her at the same time, like, living with her as well. Almost to the point where they were like, you should, like, do Koinonia, and I'm like, I don't know. It was still pretty much COVID and everything. We were wearing masks during our Koinonia. My K family was about 5 people in total, so when I was with them, we like lost every game because we were so small. But it was still fun. I met some cool people. Ended up being friends with my roommate's K family, which was really fun. And you know, that was kind of my first taste into making new friends. But I still wasn't really connecting with people. I didn't want to get connected with the church just because I had been serving all my life. I want to take a break is kind of what I put into my mind. I was like, I've been playing the piano for a while for my mom and my dad. Like, I'm good. I'll just take a break. Well, that break didn't last very long. I ended up serving at FBC and playing for the university students. Kind of got into that, and I was like, well, I don't know, like, if this is for me. Music was just kind of pushed into my life. Because my parents did it, I kind of had to do it, so it wasn't like a forceful thing, but it was like, you kind of have to. And so in college, I was like, no music, not even choir, but then found out choir tryouts were happening, so I tried out for choir. Ended up getting into international choir, and I'm in Wayland Singers, and I was like, well, I guess I'm in music a little bit. realized that I liked music a lot more. I think because I kind of chose it for myself and kind of came upon it. And all of these people in choir were great people to hang around. And Dr. Harrington made music fun. And so I was learning things that I didn't know. My first semester kind of ended. I ended up having these two amazing friends, and then they leave and don't come back to Wayland the next semester. So I have like zero friends when I come back, and it just really hit me hard. I was like, I have to do this again? Like, I have to make friends again? Like, what am I supposed to do? Well, the Lord put great people into my life that helped me through a really tough time as well. And that was really awesome to actually have Christian friends with me. And so through all of that, I realized that music and maybe worship leading was kind of something I wanted to do. I'd been doing it a little bit more, but by my own choice. And because of that, I changed my major to music production. I was like, okay, you know, not fully music, but I can dabble in music here and there, and then I can also, you know, run cameras and stuff. Kind of was my thought process. Then realized, actually, I really do like music, so I switched to a full music major. And I minor in music production, which is really cool. Never thought that I would be majoring in music. That was just something so far away that I definitely would have never thought. But through that, like, it has given me so many opportunities to learn and grow all of my my talents that I have to play and to sing as well. And so just even though college is hard to navigate through and you don't know what you want to do, it's okay to not know. I didn't know for a while, and so once you find that, you will finally have peace, and the Lord will show you that as well. Worship is a big part of my life, and now I think I want to be a worship leader, whether I'm actually leading the team or I'm, you know, serving on a team. I think that's where my place is. So, yeah, thank you.
What's up, y'all? Y'all doing all right? What's up, y'all? Y'all doing all right, man? Lock in. Wake up. Perfect. Thank you. My name is Evan Mickens. Many of you know me. Short introduction. I've been at Wayland a long time. I think some of y'all were in middle school, and I was a freshman here. So you can do the math. But my word is on a quick word on worship. And if I'm going to be like really like transparent with y'all, I didn't have anything. I'm like, worship? Do I talk about like what is worship? How do we worship? What do we do when we worship? But I guess I can give y'all a little bit of it all in this quick time. And so when I heard worship, the first thing that comes to my mind is John 4. There's this woman at this well, and Jesus goes to her, and they're talking. They're having dialogue about this and about that. And Jesus says something along the lines that, those who worship the Father must worship him in spirit and in truth. And so, first of all, what is worship? Anybody, what is worship? What comes to y'all's mind when y'all hear worship? Music, for sure. Anything else? Acknowledging, praising God. Perfect. These are all acts of worship. But what sets this text out particularly is that Christ said that the ones who worship must worship him in spirit and in truth. So we on the worship team, you know, we sing these songs, you know, we sing these songs. We pray, we try to live our lives out. We try to live like Christ daily. But what sets any individual apart is worshiping God in spirit and in truth. What is spirit and the truth? Somebody asked me that. Thank y'all for asking me. To worship spirit and the truth is first, when we worship God in spirit, it lets us know that our heart is connected to God. We are giving reverence to God based off our heart posture. That is what spirit is. And worshiping him in truth is taking the word as truth and knowing God to be truth in our lives. Amen. And so when I see this woman, and she's like, you Jews say that we have to worship here. Certain people say we have to worship here. We have to go to church and worship. We have to go to this and worship and this and worship. And that's okay. But to worship God in spirit and his truth can literally be to worship him anywhere. And singing is not the only way y'all can worship too. You can also worship God through your prayer. You worship God through your actions. You worship God through your faith. You worship God through your testimony. It's literally just giving reverence to God every second, every day, and every moment of your life. Amen? Amen. Perfect. That's good. And so I have one more example. You guys can go ahead, go up, because we're running out of time. I have one more example of worship. And God literally just gave me this. I told y'all I had nothing. But there's this man by the name of Job. Job in the Bible was this man. He was truly blessed by God. He had absolutely everything. I'm talking about cattle on cattle, pigs on pigs. I'm talking about everything you needed. Job had it. But there was a moment where God tested Job, tested his faithfulness, and God took just about everything. He allowed Satan to take just about everything away from Job, right? So what we see in this passage is Job has lost everything. His wife has told him to curse God. His family has passed away. And now Job's stuck with nothing. Absolutely nothing. Job has nothing. But there's this verse that reads in Job 1:20. It says, at this, Job got up and tore his robe and shaved his head. Then he fell to the ground and worshiped and said, naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked I will depart. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be praised. May the name of the Lord be praised. And so I got to give Luke credit this, but I was talking to Luke. I'm like, man, what should I say? And Luke just said something. He was like, man, worship offends pride. Worship offends pride. And it's so, in fact, Job had absolutely everything. When everything was taken away from him, he still gave God the praise. And that's what true worship is that whenever we're going through something, whether good or bad, we still reverence God as God. We still reverence God as holy. We still reverence him as the Savior, the Messiah of the world. Amen. I believe it's in Revelations when the angels are crying out, holy, holy, holy. No, that's Isaiah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. You know, who is worthy to be praised. And that's what worship is. We know God to be holy. We know him to be true. And so we worship him when we're down and when we're up. Amen. All right, let's stand. Can I pray for you guys? Father God, thank you for this wonderful day. Thank you for your life. Thank you for your love, your grace, your mercy, and your peace you bestow upon us every day. Father God, I pray that we continue to worship you in spirit and truth, Father. I pray that anything we do is not in vain, Father. I pray that in the moments that we don't even feel like it, Father, in the moments that we don't feel like these words have power, Father, that you make it clear to us, Father, that these words hold so much weight, Father, in our hearts and in your heart too. Praying for the believers, praying for the unbelievers, Father, that they may to you, Father. Praying for the believers that they may continue to worship you, Father. Pray for this chapel worship team as they continue to endure, Father, and face all types of different obstacles, Father. I pray for the student body, Father, as they face all different types of obstacles, Father. I just pray that we worship you in spirit and in truth, Father. You are holy. You are sovereign. And your name shall greatly be praised. In Jesus' name, I pray. We have one more song for you guys. Speed it up a little bit, Luke.
Our hearts adore. just Drew.
Say, Jesus, we love you.
Come on, Wayland.
Oh, how. Oh, how we love you.
And you are.
You are the one.
Our hearts adore.
Our hearts adore.
One more time.
Say, Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore.
Our hearts adore.
Amen. Let me pray you guys out. Father God, thank you for this wonderful day, Father. As I mentioned before, Father, I pray that we continue to worship you in spirit and in truth, Father. Pray for these students, Father. Pray for this team, Father, that we may continue to thrive throughout the rest of the week, Father. First, giving reverence to you, Father, and acknowledging one another, Father, and just loving, you know, just having a loving and caring spirit towards one another, Father. I pray that everyone who has an ear, Father, they heard something today, Father, and that we can continue to just bless your name, Father. You are holy, you are wonderful, and we thank you for that. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Our affection, our devotion, poured out on the feet of Jesus. Our affection, our devotion,
poured out on the feet of Jesus.
Our affection,
our
devotion,
our devotion, poured out on the feet of Jesus.
Our affection. Jesus, we love you.
Oh, how.
Oh, how we love you.
Yeah, yeah.
You are the one to adore.
Say, Jesus, we love you.
So heaven meets earth like a sloppy wet kiss, and my heart turns violently inside of my chest, and I don't have time to maintain these regrets when I think about the way that he loves us. Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves us.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. How he loves.
Say, everybody, he longs.
Yeah, he loves.
Oh, how.
Oh, how he loves.
Yeah.
Oh, how he loves us. Oh, how he loves.
Looking at vocals.
Yeah, he.
Other song is in 3/4.